Hey gamers, what's going on? Since I finally have a real NES and I can try a few things on it, I just had to make a video specifically about the NES lockout chip and how I managed to defeat it without modding my console. So basically, when Nintendo released the Famicom in 1983, everyone potentially could make their own cartridges for it. And these cartridges would work on the system without any problems, like mine did. I guess it wasn't a big deal in Japan, or on the contrary, perhaps it was a huge deal, because when Nintendo decided to rebrand the Famicom as the NES and release it in 1985 in the US, they decided to install a so-called lockout system, or a CiC chip, that would prevent any unauthorized cartridges from running on the NES. One might say they just wanted to protect their precious system from a bunch of crappy games that Westerners would try to make. For this protection, Nintendo used a microcontroller that was manufactured by Sharp. It's a small 16-pin chip that might look like a logic chip, but in fact it's a simple 4-bit computer that probably was also used in calculators or TV remotes. For the protection system to work, you had to have two identical chips like that, with the identical application running on them. Depending on the configuration, one chip acted as a lock and it went into your console. And the second one was a key and it was located inside of the license cartridge. Both chips were communicating using two wires and sending each other very specific sequences of data depending on what region your console and the game was from. If something didn't match what the lock chip would expect to receive, it would simply initiate a reset of your console. For instance, if you put an NES game that was published in Germany into a German console, everything would be great and the game would run just fine. But if you would try to put, let's say, an American game into the same console, as soon as you turn the power on, the screen would start blinking, because the American cartridge sent an incorrect data sequence to the lock chip. Also, you can see the same blinking when the system is turned on without any cartridge. This was actually very good protection. In fact, it was so good that Nintendo used it up until N64, and even N64 system was kinda similar to this. Those pesky Westerners wanted to publish their little crappy games without Nintendo's approval really bad. So back in the day when the NES was still relevant, these clever developers created several ways to defeat the CiC chip. Most of the methods used were a brute force hacks, where a cartridge would generate a negative 5 volt current that would zap and crash the lock chip. I'm not sure if it's a good idea to replicate these hacks for your own homebrew game, but I will put a link in the description if you want to read more about them. The Atari subsidiary Tengen, on other hand, managed to swipe the source code of the application that was running on the CiC chip from the US Patent Office. You see, it's not enough to copy the chip. Like, you can unlit the original and study it with a microscope and then reproduce the circuitry, but you won't have the key codes that were present in the application that was running on the original chip. That's why Tengen had to get their hands on that application. So with the stolen code, they could create a perfect clone chip that was named Rabbit. This clone successfully unlocked the protection system without brute force or ugly hacks. You can still find this chip in Tengen's cartridges like Gauntlet, Pac-Man and many others. Of course, in 1988, Nintendo sued Tengen for that, and Tengen had to recall all the unsold games. Many years later, in 2006, after the patent of the CiC chip expired, the NES hackers on the NESdev forums tried to figure out how actually the CiC chip worked. How come nobody knows how to break such an old system? Even the Nintendo DS was already hacked at the time. Instead of going after the original Nintendo's CiC chip, they went after the Rabbit by Tengen, because apparently it had a debug mode. To be honest, while reading this reverse engineering forum thread, I was looking for a ready-made solution. What seemed odd to me that a lot of posts in this thread was just deleted, and many links were not working anymore. For a moment I thought maybe Nintendo demanded for the stuff to be removed, or maybe the posters themselves were too afraid that something like that might happen. Still, I'm glad this thread led people to figure out the algorithm of the application that was running on CiC, and to create modern solutions using widely available hardware that's more up-to-date, like for instance the PIC or Atmel microcontrollers. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, I wanted to try out one of those modern solutions on my NES. After some searching, I stumbled upon this repository that belongs to krikzz himself. If you don't know, he's the Ukrainian guy who created the EverDrive. His repository has a code for the Atmel's A-Tiny13 chip. This code should also work on the A-Tiny13A. It might work on some other Atmel microcontrollers, but since I never used this type of microcontrollers before, I have no clue. So eventually I bought a couple of A-Tiny13As. Apparently my cheap Chinese EEPROM programmer also support these microcontrollers, so I don't need to buy anything else to program them. I didn't want to make another cartridge PCB from scratch, so how about making just an NES adapter for my Famicom cartridge, so I could just put the microcontroller into this adapter. Of course, I'm not making anything new or groundbreaking. You can find adapters like these on eBay for 10 bucks or something. But come on, making things with your own hands is much more fun. So I got to work and designed the PCB with KiCad. I found that I need to flip the Famicom connector, or it would have been a nightmare to route the tracks. I etched the PCB as usual in my kitchen with some sodium persulfate. Then I covered the PCB with some solder, and I soldered in the socket for the chip. And lastly, I soldered the Famicom cartridge connector. Now it was time to flash the chip and test if it actually works. But since I never worked with the Atmel microcontrollers, I accidentally flashed the ELF file, and that was a big mistake, and obviously nothing worked. Also, it looked like the laminate that I made the adapter from is way more thicker than an average NES cartridge PCB. I think most NES cards are like 1 millimeter thick, and mine is about 1.5 millimeters. So I don't even need to put a pressure or pull the cartridge lever down for the cartridge to work. But also, that means it's not a good idea to use this adapter very often, because it might eventually ruin the NES cartridge slot. On my second attempt, I finally wrote a hex file to the flash memory of the microcontroller. Now I needed to set the fuse flags, but the explanation would not make much sense to me. The options in my programmer's application were a bit different. What helped me was the lower and higher byte values that were in this picture. I tried to match them. I set the high value to a hexadecimal 251 and low value to 112. I'm not sure about the calibration byte, but for me the chip didn't work when I left it disabled, so I checked the write to EEPROM option. After I wrote both the application and the configuration to the chip, I could finally put it into the socket and see if it actually works. You might still think it doesn't work, right? But actually this time you need to press the reset button 4 times when the power LED lights up. 1, 2, 3, and 4. And voila, it finally works! After that, the application should store your console's region in the microcontroller's EEPROM memory. So when you insert the cartridge into your console again, you won't need to press the reset button repeatedly again. I think you can actually preset the region in the EEPROM when you flash the chip, so the cartridge would work out of the box, but I haven't tried that. So yeah, I finally made a game that actually runs on a real NES. The cartridge looks like it came from the Stone Age, or maybe from some distant post-apocalyptic future. But hey, it works. I even attached a strap so you could pull out the cartridge easily.
Get over here!
I think Muramasa shop has PCBs for cartridges like this. And if you live in the US, it might be much cheaper to buy from them than to try to make everything yourself. But hey, I proved that it's still possible to make a working cartridge from scratch. So I guess that's about it. Thanks for watching, subscribe the channel if you like my content, and I will see you next time. Bye.